Lithuanian heritage is still not very well known, and I aim to change that.
Hello and welcome. This is Ruta Nojokaitė, and you're listening to Lithuanian Dream Podcast. Today we are inviting you to meet real Indiana Jones of Lithuania. He traveled the world and collected Lithuanian heritage sites. His name is Augustinas Zemaitis. He runs three websites and has traveled to more than 130 different countries. After doing that, he decided to start collecting information about Lithuanian heritage around the world. Augustinas, thank you for joining us today.
Thank you.
So I heard you're traveling. Where are you now?
I'm now in Brazil.
And what are you doing there?
Researching Lithuanian heritage in Brazil, Lithuanian heritage sites in Brazil, of which there are many, as between the First and Second World War, Brazil was one of the key destinations for Lithuanian immigrants to emigrate to. And here they have left after them churches, street names, monuments, and clubs, and other things that are very interesting to research, as they are almost as old as Republic of Lithuania itself. Also, I am helping people researching their roots, or helping people to restore the Lithuanian citizenship. And so I will also meet some of my clients here.
Oh, wow, this is incredible. So you're doing quite a few things at the same time in Brazil. How many trips like that you already did before?
It is difficult to say because some of my expeditions for researching Lithuanian heritage, for example, in the United States of America, are entirely dedicated to that. Those projects are partly funded by either government of Lithuania or other Lithuanian institutions, and it is just 24 hours dedicated for Lithuanian heritage research. So, for example, it was Destination Lithuanian America. It was a project for the centenary of Lithuanian Republic. And we have visited and photographed and marked coordinates and created an online map of more than 650 Lithuanian heritage sites in USA and Canada. And then again, every time I am in a foreign country, even for entirely other purposes, such as traveling, I try to research whatever Lithuanian sites exist in that location. And I also visit these sites. Of course, in some countries, such as United States of America, it is possible to dedicate entire months and still not visit or discover or mark every site or meet people and meet Lithuanian Americans and talk to them and learn the histories of these sites. But in many other countries, such as, for example, Bulgaria or Turkey, there are just a few sites that warrant inclusion into the Global True Lithuania Encyclopedia of Lithuanian Heritage that I am creating online. So these countries do not warrant a separate expedition for that. But since I am traveling, I am able to give some time for Lithuanian heritage as well. And I visit these sites. And so in total, in my Encyclopedia of Lithuanian Heritage Sites Abroad, there are more than 36 countries included.
Wow, this is incredible. I think you are a real treasure for Lithuania. It's incredible that you managed to do so many things. So you have a few websites. You have True Lithuania, you have Global True Lithuania, and Map of True Lithuania, where you put these heritage maps. And this is great that people can find the things about our culture. And if they have roots in Lithuania, they can use it to discover. So how come you just decided that your life, or big chunk of your life now, is going to be about Lithuanian heritage?
The start of it, the first website I created in this direction was truelithuania.com, which is the largest English website on Lithuania, except for the news websites. And basically, as travel is one of my hobbies, I was traveling in foreign countries, and I noticed what kind of information a foreigner needs about those countries. Like, it must be from the beginning, it should not assume that you already know many things. And yet at the same time, it would be quite complete, but it should be also quite short. So it shouldn't be like a book on every subject. And travel guidebooks like Lonely Planet and such, they kind of do that. And I wanted to do a thing like that on Lithuania, but online and freely available for all. And so I did truelithuania.com. And I noticed that many people who are not really tourists, but are people of Lithuanian heritage who were reading the website, they were asking me various questions about their own forefathers, what their surnames must have been, what kind of lives they have led while in Lithuania before emigrating. And I noticed also when traveling that there are very many grand Lithuanian sites abroad that the descendants, the emigrants and their descendants have created. Like Lithuanian churches in America are as grand as cathedrals in Lithuania itself. And there are Lithuanian club palaces in America that are older than the Republic of Lithuania and so on. And people in Lithuania or even in other cities of America or even non-Lithuanians in America, they knew very little about it. And so I decided that somebody needs to collect this all information before it dies out as the generations changes and put it online as well, so it would be easily accessible to everybody. So that's how I started my second project, and it's Gabalėliai Lietuvos or Global True Lithuania, which is about the Lithuanian heritage abroad. And I visit each of the cities. I create like encyclopedia article on the city and Lithuanian heritage that exists there. I talk to local Lithuanians, usually old people, who tell me their stories, and I write them down, condense them into an article, like encyclopedia article. This is then accessible in both Lithuanian and English languages, in Lithuanian for people in Lithuania, so they would know it, and if they travel in those countries, they could visit these places. And in English language for other descendants of Lithuanians and even non-Lithuanians, like researchers of diversity, of immigrant heritage, who now research, for example, Jewish heritage or Irish heritage, but Lithuanian heritage is still not very well known, and I aim to change that.
It's incredible. Thank you so much for doing this huge work. One person is collecting all this information that otherwise would be lost in the history, or, you know, we wouldn't even know about it. So actually, you mentioned the change of generations. And because I was myself involved in political campaign, like voting encouragement campaign of Lithuanians around the world recently, we encouraged people to vote in parliamentary elections. We have understood that people in US, although there are a lot of people with Lithuanian citizenship in US, they vote much less than previously. And it might be because of the generation change. Do you think it's possible for us to contain the spirit of Lithuanian heritage within the third generation of Lithuanians, or it's already lost?
I think it is possible, but work needs to be done there. And here in South America, for example, I visited a great Lithuanian club in Berisso, Argentina. And it is very interesting because nobody there is actually born in Lithuania. The immigration happened between the world wars, and people are sons and grandsons and even great-grandsons or great-granddaughters of original immigrants. Many of them are mixed, but I was surprised to learn that people speak Lithuanian well, like people of my age, I mean, and people also do folk dances and all the other activities. But unfortunately, that clubs like that are more of an exception rather than a rule. Then yet again in Berisso, it was interesting for me to learn that the generation of my parents, let's say, that generation actually spoke Lithuanian and did less Lithuanian activities than my own generation. And that means that nothing is lost as long as Lithuanian clubs, Lithuanian parishes, other Lithuanian heritage still exist. As long as people are around them, it is possible perhaps to reignite that flame. Now, another thing is what we have to do for it. So that's another question. Just one more thing. I wouldn't want to say that the main thing about Lithuanianness is like voting in elections or such, because as I visited all these locations, I noticed there are very, very many ways people retain their Lithuanian heritage, extremely different ways from each other. And all of them are interesting, good and nice, as long as people do something about it.
So what are the ways people preserve the culture? Is it language mostly, or what are the things?
In later generations, perhaps language is more of an exception, such as in Berisso, for example, because it takes time to learn language, and especially in mixed families or in places where very few Lithuanians live, there is quite little use for the language. So in later generations, usually it's folk dances, folk traditions, like simply researching Lithuanian heritage, reading books about Lithuania. Unfortunately, as many of these people have lost their language, that means they have access to relatively few resources about it, because few resources are, for example, available about Lithuanian songs in English online. I mean, traditional Lithuanian songs and such. And with TrueLithuania.com, I aim to change that, and I am very glad that in some Lithuanian clubs, I even discovered by accident that they have printed out my articles about Lithuanian heritage and Lithuanian traditions, and that helps them to understand them. But it's very important to present that in English as well, because there may be hundreds of thousands of people who speak Lithuanian outside Lithuania, and yet there are millions who are of Lithuanian heritage, and for them, Lithuania is not simply a dot on the map, but, well, they are unable or just to dedicate entire lives research relatively simple things. But if that is accessible, it is much easier to attract more people to it.
For sure. And you mentioned million people, so you cannot do it yourself. Like, just preserve all of this. So what us as Lithuanians around the world or our government should do, maybe top three priorities of preserving Lithuanian culture?
So I think the first priority for me and why I chose myself to do this work is Lithuanian heritage. I mean, Lithuanian heritage, like Lithuanian cemeteries, Lithuanian churches, Grand Duchy of Lithuania castles, graves of famous Lithuanians, Lithuanian-named places, memorials for Lithuanians, and all those things that exist in many countries, and which I document in the Global True Lithuania Encyclopedia. And why this Lithuania? Because as long as it exists, as in case of the Lithuanian club in Berisa, Argentina, I mentioned, people are attracted to them. People still see a piece of Lithuania in their land. The new generations could be shown, let's say, it was a great Lithuanian poet, you know, and he lived in this city. And this is Lithuanian Museum. You can learn about Lithuanian heritage here. And this is memorial for Lithuanians murdered in the Soviet genocide. And, well, that's the story behind that and all this. So these sites tend to attract, and as long as they exist, there is a chance for continuation and rebirth of Lithuanian culture, even when it is lost. I have seen numerous such cases of rebirth around all Lithuanian clubs and institutions. But unfortunately, many of these sites are threatened. As long as they are not recognized as heritage by the local authorities, as often happens in America, they may be demolished, for example. They may be sold to another owner, and the owner may just demolish it. And a lot of Grand Lithuanian churches were lost this way, and some memorials. So I think it's very important that people, including new generations of Lithuanian immigrants, would recognize this and would seek to preserve all that Lithuanian heritage, to join the Lithuanian institutions, to support them, to go to their events, and like lobby the governments and try to campaign the media, so learn about it, so that people around, not only other Lithuanians, but other people would also understand them as important.
Yeah, for sure. Even in Berlin, where I live, we have some monuments as well, which are related to Lithuania. And I get to know them slowly because our embassy organizes events around these places. But it's quite interesting to see that people before us lived here, and there are like different waves of migration to the country. And when you come to the country, there's already a history of Lithuanians in that country too. So it's quite amazing. So what did you learn from traveling and seeing Lithuanians around the world?
So I think the most important thing I learned was how the history of Lithuania looked completely different from like America or places behind the Iron Curtain, and how it looked from there, and how they see Lithuania today. It's too much to say like in a single podcast, because there are entirely different viewpoints on these issues and entirely different groups of people. And I learned that there were, up until like 90s or 2000s, there were still very strong divisions, for example, among leftist Lithuanians and Christian Democratic Lithuanians. and tautininkai. So basically, it was like a continuation of the divisions that existed in interwar Lithuania. Often when I visit these sites, I am amazed that I kind of visit interwar Lithuania that no longer exists in Lithuania itself, but still exists better among the people who left Lithuania at that time. Unfortunately, I also learned how much has been closed or is being closed or being destroyed. And it's very important that we would put a stop to that, as people have all over the world has already recognized, for example, Jewish heritage and heritage of other nations. So we must help people understand that Lithuanian heritage is important as well. And I also understood just how many people have Lithuanian roots outside Lithuania. And it is easy to say, well, they don't speak Lithuanian language, so they are no longer Lithuanians. But still, that connection exists. And for them, Lithuania is not simply a dot on the map as any other country in Europe. And when, for example, they decide where to travel in Europe, for them, Lithuania as a choice is on par with Paris or Rome, because simply those maybe are more interesting sites, but in Lithuania, they are personally interesting because they would see the places where their forefathers have lived and how they lived. And so that's a great like trump card of Lithuania in attracting tourism, attracting foreign investments, because maybe we don't have like wonders of the world like France does or Italy does. And maybe our economy is still younger, but we have more people abroad compared to the current population of Lithuania than nearly every other country of the world, with just a few exceptions, maybe Ireland or such. So we need to use that. And I learned that it is possible.
So what can we do today to save these heritage sites? As I hear you repeating it as a huge, huge problem for us nowadays that we don't really recognize. Is this a problem more prominent in certain countries like US, where diaspora had more churches maybe?
I actually wrote a very long article in Global True Lithuania in both Lithuanian and English languages about many ways a person can act to save this heritage. But an important thing that there needs firstly to be understanding that this heritage is important, and that understanding must cover all different groups of Lithuanians. So as I find out, usually it is so that people like local Lithuanians of the very same city know this heritage very well. But that's about it. People from other cities, even Lithuanian people, do not know it well. People, non-Lithuanian people from the same city do not know it because it was never presented like in English language well enough. The Republic of Lithuania institutions, even like embassies or consulates, very often do not know this heritage either. They know some of it, like in the same cities they operate, but not in the other cities, and so on. So it's very important to collect that information in a single place, which I try to do. And it's very important to disseminate it as far as possible. And I think it is possible, like with the Jewish heritage in Lithuania that I have mentioned. So as it is written about, Lithuanian people read about, they start to care about it, and they start to get interesting because those are interesting stories. And the same can be done about Lithuanian heritage abroad, especially as people travel more now. And well, not this year, maybe, but still, and people have more connections now to the places abroad. Of course, I think some of the things that also are important, it is important to use the positive sides of the 21st century, because a lot has changed. One thing that has been detrimental for these old Lithuanian institutions and heritage is that it is now not popular, let's say, to dedicate entire life to a single parish or to a single club in the way it was 50 years ago and 60 years ago, and the way these clubs and parishes and all the other heritage was built. On the other hand, there are many positive things, like the world is now more globalized, so you can attract attention and support from beyond the city itself. And then there is that part-time volunteerism, which is also very popular these days. So you can attract, for example, for a Lithuanian museum to survive and be more, let's say, actual for the population. You can maybe attract students from universities to act as part-time guides, as volunteers. And that also happens, but it's still difficult for some institutions to do that transition. So it's very important to actually collaborate to share the information. As I learned, some, for example, one institution has found a way to apply for grants from local state or national authorities, and yet others do not know it. And it's important to share because Republic of Lithuania exists today. It is free. It no longer needs that much of support. Actually, it itself supports the Lithuanian heritage abroad. But the problem is also that it doesn't know everything. So it's very important to share information. And I think with sharing information and with putting all our attention to it, attracting other people who simply do not know this heritage exists, it is possible to save more of it. And as for countries, well, the problem is more or less similar all over the world, although, yeah, as you say, in USA, it's perhaps more acute, and that's because the view towards heritage is different there. So, if, for example, in Europe, you can easily demolish a 19th century building, usually because of the various heritage codes, while in USA, it's pretty easy as long as there is no like popular movement against such demolition, and that's what we need to do.
Well, this is quite great that you already have this map, and I will look at it and see. Let's do something together, maybe raise some awareness about some of the sites so there could be more call to action to people. This is something very important that we have responsibility to keep for the next generations. And sometimes people think that just old people are interested in the history, but both of us, even new generation, has an interest and really want to keep the things that were important to the people before us. What is your own personal dream for Lithuanians' future?
So my own dream is that Lithuanians would be able to go their own way. They would not imitate either East or West, and they would respect their own culture, history, and heritage and research it. And they would not think that this heritage is somehow inferior to any other heritage. They would find inspiration in it. And they would be able and try to explain the differences between Lithuanian and other countries' history to people who do not understand it or who try to like attack it or evaluate it from the very different perspective without taking into account the different history of Lithuania. So I think what I actually learned also when traveling these 113 countries as well, economy or technology may be better or worse. I mean, there are more advanced or less advanced countries in terms of economy and technology, but all the cultures are equal. There are no like better cultures. And it is not so that Western culture is better than Lithuanian culture, for example. So it's very important to understand this difference. And unfortunately, often people do not, and often people like, especially coming from poorer countries, like emigrating abroad, they tend to degrade their own country. They think that if it is poorer, then maybe it's worse in every direction possible. Maybe its culture is also worse and such. And on the contrary, countries that happen to be rich, even if they are non-Western, they tend to value their country very much. For example, Japan or South Korea or Arabic Gulf countries where people still wear their ethnic gloves and is considered as good as formal black tie wear and so on. So I think, and I hope so, as Lithuania gets richer and its economy improves, Lithuanians will also respect their history and culture more, and we'll see it as equal to all the other cultures, and we'll be able to understand when others degrade it simply because they do not understand it, and we'll be able to explain it. And so the Lithuanian culture and heritage will thrive here and abroad.
Yes, for sure. It's very inspiring. So let's be proud of where we come from. And let's not look at others. Just be proud and try to be the best we can, preserve it. And thank you so much, Augustinas, for coming and sharing your story with us today. I think a lot of people will be inspired to do action with the heritage of their own family or maybe Lithuanian heritage points in their country. Thank you.
Thank you very much. I hope so too.